What is the difference between illness, disease, suffering, and death? In the West, we consider these things as one package, but there is a vast difference. Illness, disease, and suffering are one thing, and death is a totally different thing. Remember that the physician or the healer never heals. He can only make the healing force of the whole available to the patient. And it is only the whole that can heal. It is not the physician, it is not the medicine either that heals. The medicine, the physician, the hospital all bring the part back closer to the whole so that the healing can begin. They are just instrumental in bringing the patient who has got disconnected with the whole, bringing close to the whole. Illness, disease, and suffering come in one category, and death is another category. Death is beautiful, illness is not, suffering is not, disease is not. Death is beautiful. It is not a sword that cuts your life. It is like a flower, the ultimate flowering. If birth is the beginning, then death is the ultimate flowering, the final offering. It is the flower that blossoms at the last moment. It is the peak. Death is the flower that grows on the tree of life, but the crescendo. It is the ultimate orgasm. There is nothing wrong in death. It is beautiful. But one needs to know how to live. And if you have known how to live, you know how to die. The moment an individual dies, tremendous energy is released at that time. If you are available to that very moment when someone is dying, you can be enlightened that very moment. There is an art of living and there is an art of dying. And the second art is of more value than the first one. But the second can be known only when you have known the first, how to live. How to live rightly, then death becomes a door to the divine. So the first thing is keep death apart. Only think of illness, disease, and suffering. You need not fight against death. And this is what is creating trouble in the modern mind. People are fighting against death. They are vegetating in the hospital, just alive on drugs. They are forced to live unnecessarily when they would have died naturally. Through medical support, their death is being postponed. They are of no use. Life is of no use for them. The game is over. They are finished. Now keep them alive just to make them suffer more. Sometimes they may be in a coma, and a person can be in a coma for months and years. But because there is an antagonism against death, it has become a great problem in the Western mind. What to do when a person is in a coma and will never recover? But he can be kept alive for years. He will be a corpse, just a breathing corpse and nothing else. What is the point? Why not allow him to die? There is a constant fear of death in human mind. Death is enemy, and how to surrender to the enemy. So there is a great controversy. What to do? Should a person be allowed to die? Should a person be allowed to decide whether he wants to die? Should the family be allowed to decide whether they would like him to die? Because sometimes the person may be unconscious and cannot decide, but it is right to help somebody to die. Great fear arises to die. That means you are murdering the person. The whole of science exists to keep him alive. Now this is stupid. Life in itself has no value unless there is a joy, unless there is a dance, unless there is creativity, unless there is love. Life in itself is meaningless. Just to live is meaningless. A point comes when one has lived. A point comes when it is natural to die, when it is beautiful to die. Just as when you have been doing the work the whole day, a point comes when you fall asleep. Death is a kind of sleep, a deeper one. You will be born again in a newer body, with a newer mechanism, with few facilities, with more opportunities, new challenges. This old body, and one has to leave it, is just a doing. But there are people who are afraid of even sleep. And I have heard an author saying there is no need to sleep. It is a wastage of time. A person lives almost one third of his life in sleep, and that is not living at all, because in sleep he creates nothing. He does not work. What is the point of keeping a man asleep? Sooner or later they will start finding drugs so that man can avoid sleep completely. Just think of the world where sleep has become impossible. They won't allow you even to sleep. In Russia, they have invented instruments to teach children while they are asleep. Now, will you not leave even the sleep alone? It is called hypnoteaching. A tape recorder is connected, and the whole night the tape recorder goes on teaching mathematics, history, geography, etc. The child has been tortured the whole day in the school. Now you cannot even allow him to rest in the night. Western mind is utilitarian. It does not believe in rest. Instead, it believes in work. The whole ethos is that of work, not of relaxation. In the morning, child has to go back to the school, but in the night we play the tape. And this author suggests that there is a possibility that through some drugs, sleep can be completely removed and man can live awake for 70 years. Just think of the nightmare. Those people who are against sleep are against death too. They are against any kind of relaxation, let go, just go on fighting. East have a totally different outlook. Death is not an enemy, instead a friend. Death gives you a rest. You have become tired, you have lived your life, you have known all the joys that can be known in life. You have burnt your candle totally. Now go into darkness, rest for a while, and then you can be born again. Death will revive you again in a fresher way. So first thing to be remembered, that death is the ultimate crescendo on the tree of life. Death is the greatest experience if you can die consciously. And you can die consciously if you are not against it. If you are against it, you will become very panic and afraid. When you are so afraid that you cannot tolerate that fear, there is a natural mechanism in the body which releases drugs when you are unconscious. There is a point beyond which endurance will not be possible. You become unconscious. So millions of people die unconsciously and miss the great moment, the greatest of all. And to die consciously is samadhi, a satori, a meditation happening to you. It is a natural gift. If you have been around the sheikhs and masters when they enter into Alam-e-Ghaib, it is a tremendous experience. If you can be alert and you can see that you are not the body, you will have to see, because body will disappear. Soon you will be able to see that you are not the body. Instead, you are separate. Then you will see you are participating from the mind too. Then mind will disappear. And then you will be just a flame of awareness. And that is the greatest benediction there is. Buddha entered into Mahaparinirvana. That is why it is called Mahaparinirvana. First his physical body dissolved, then the mental body, and finally the flame disappeared. So never think of death as illness, disease, and human suffering. Illness, disease, and suffering are bad because they happen only when you are not natural. Something has gone wrong. Health is natural, death is natural, but disease is not. Disease is simply an indication that something is going wrong in your nature. For example, you have eaten too much, there will be a pain in the stomach. This pain is not natural. You have done something unnatural. You have not slept for 2 or 3 days because you were running after money, and it was not possible for you to sleep. Or you were fighting an election and it was not possible for you to sleep or to afford that much time for rest. You were on an election campaign, so you have not slept for 3 days. Now the head is becoming neurotic, bursting. There is a great pain. This is just a symptom. Nature is saying to you to return, to come back. You have gone far away. Man is free and he can be natural. Many kinds of disease happen only when we go somewhere astray from nature. If man lives naturally, there will be no disease. But man cannot live naturally continuously because he has freedom. Sometimes you can eat a little too much, that is your freedom. And sometimes you can go on a fast, that too is your freedom. Man is the only animal in the world who has this freedom, that is his dignity. But with freedom comes dangers. The first danger is that you can go against nature. The nature is so polite that it does not shout, it whispers. Nature is very silent. Its voice is still and small. It goes on saying, do not do it. Do not do it. And it goes on tolerating. There is a point beyond which it cannot tolerate, and it results in disease. Disease erupts. Now, what is the physician meant to do? In the East, physician does not fight disease. The physician does not meant to destroy the disease. The physician is simply meant to bring back you to your nature. Physician is not correcting the nature. He is only correcting the man. This is a totally different vision. He is correcting the man. Nature is always correct. Sometimes man can be wrong because he has freedom. The physician corrects the man. You will be surprised to know in China there are traditional medicines, a very ancient tradition, that when a person falls ill, he stops paying the physician. This used to happen 5,000 years ago. Otherwise, the physician has to pay him. If a person remains healthy, he has to pay a premium to the physician for keeping him healthy. But if he falls ill, he stops paying. That means the physician has not been looking at nature and has not been helping the nature, and he has not been helping him to keep in tune with nature. The physician has failed, so he has to pay. This is a strange outlook. When you are ill, you go to the doctor and you pay. In China, for centuries, they have been paying when they are healthy. They go to their doctor and pay because they are healthy. The doctor keeps them healthy. When they are ill, they stop paying. Why should they pay? The doctor has not doing his job. His job is to keep the patient natural. This will be the vision in future. Sooner or later, this vision has to come. Doctor is not against nature. He is putting people right because they have freedom to go wrong. So there is no need to keep yourself miserable that you are not doing something good. But then there is a refusal to accept disease and illness. Yes, there is a refusal to accept disease and illness because they are not natural. They mean going astray. Put man right. You are fighting against the whole. You are fighting for the whole against man. Let it be looked at in this way. You are not fighting the whole when you are fighting the disease. You are fighting a part which is going against the whole. It is the part, if the part is in tune with the whole, in harmony, then there is no disease, no illness. Man has freedom. And with freedom comes danger. If you go in the forest, you will be surprised to see that animals are almost never ill. I am not talking about animals who live in a zoo and they fall ill. They have become human imitators. To live with human beings is very dangerous. But in forest, living in a wild situation, animals live and die, but they never fall ill. They never eat too much because they do not have that much freedom. They never fast. They do not have that much freedom. They do not have that much consciousness. They do not do anything which is unnatural. They go on doing one thing that is natural and that keeps them healthy. To eat moderately, to eat all that is natural and healthy for you is the way. Illness, there are certain illnesses like tuberculosis and cancer does not happen in nature. Cancer happens only in a very higher kind of civilization. In India, long time, tuberculosis was a royal disease. It used to happen only to the kings. Only to the kings. It never happened to the poor. It could not happen. A poor man cannot suffer that much for tuberculosis to happen. Then by and by, poor man became rich. Then tuberculosis became more and more available to everyone. Cancer is another phenomenon. It is absolutely new. It is not mentioned in the ancient medical manuals of Taoist and Hindu. It is absolutely new. It has to wait for 20th century to happen. A great tension is needed for it to happen. So much unnatural tension is needed for it to happen that it was not possible before. Only we can afford cancer. We have become affluent enough to have it. And our minds are becoming neurotic with desires. We are running in all directions and thus falling apart. You need not be worried that you are fighting against nature or against the whole. You are not fighting against nature. You are fighting against the stupidity of the part which has gone against the whole. You are bringing the person back to the whole. When you go to a function or somebody's place, when you see the items on the menu which you have not seen for a long time, you eat more than what it is needed. There has to be a stop point. Many times it happened, I inquire in a function like this, let me look at the complete menu so I can decide how much of each of these items I have to eat. You have eaten to your stomach's capacity, and then comes a good-looking dessert. It is said that you must taste it. It is very good. Many times it's said to me that it is your favorite. You must eat it. Yes, I like this. You can give it to me. I can carry it home. But right now, I am finished. A full stop has come. And my stomach is not a garbage bin where you can go on forcing the things into it. Even garbage bin refuses to accept the thing. But you as a human being do not refuse, either out of courtesy or out of greed or out of any other reason. This is being unnatural. Eat everything in a moderate. You are connected with the nature. Psychologists say when you put the food in front of the child, the food may be looking very good, but the child picks up only that much which is beneficial for his health, and not only that which he can consume at that time without creating any disruption. And this is the way you are always in tune with the nature. Sleeping in normal way, taking a required amount of rest, required amount of food. Sometimes it is good to eat light. I have heard there was a class of religious teaching. The teacher asked, Tom, do you fast? Everyone, Muslims said that we fast, a Hindu said, but Tom does not know anything. So he said, sir, I fast every day. He said, you fast every day? Yes. When I finish my dinner, I go on a fast. And in the morning when I break my fast, that is the time I take my breakfast. I am breaking my fast. And that is the term that is used by all those who go on fast. Fast means, it comes from a Hindi word, means upvas. Up means sit, vas means dwell. To come and dwell near me. Near who? Near your innerness, in a state of meditation. You can eat less and be in a fast, so your stomach gets a rest as well. The entire digestive system gets a rest. That is the real meaning of the fast. Not as a ritual that you have to fast. There is a natural tendency. When you take your last meal and in the morning you can remain without food until 10, 11 or 12. You do not feel any loss of energy. But when you start eating, every 2 or 3 hours you feel hungry. What happens in the night when you take last meal 7, 8 or 9 in the night and until next morning 10 or 11, almost 12 hours gap, you can stay without eating or drinking anything. What happens? During the sleep there is a cycle. You have to be aware of your own sleep cycles. It may be 1 hour, it may be 2 hours. When you are in a sound sleep and then you go back, you wake up, you go back to the sleep cycle, second cycle, and during that time you are connected to the whole. The nectar oozes into your being. The life force, the Alan Vaite, is infused into your being, and that alone keeps you fulfilled for the next 12 hours. But when you eat 10 o'clock or 9 o'clock breakfast, by 1 o'clock you are hungry again. But in the night you eat 9 o'clock, you can remain without consuming anything until 12 or 1 during the day. Sometimes experience this. If our food, the way we eat, all that we eat can connect us with the whole, then there is a totally a different kind of satiation. A small quantity of food keeps you satiated. When a master says, "Do you think my energy comes from the frugal meals that I eat?" it is a message to be pondered. Where does his energy come from? Does it come from food? No. It comes from his connectivity to the whole. The longer you are connected to the whole, you are part of the whole, then a different kind of satiation comes and you will not feel hungry as you will feel otherwise. This is what happens after the dinner. You can remain hungry without consuming anything for a longer period of time than when you start eating food. Neither we cook food meditatively, nor we consume food meditatively. Mechanically we say our prayers, but that prayer does not connect you to the whole. Means you are connected to your inner system, your entire digestive system, and to the whole. You are connecting your digestive system, your being, to the whole. That is what prayer means. Once that happens, you will eat meditatively in small doses, and those small doses keep you satiated and bring tremendous energy. That is why physician never heals you. The only thing he does, he connects you back to the whole. And in that very process, the healing begins to happen.